Okay, so let's start. So today we're going to talk about approximation algorithms for graph expansion. So the general problem is the following. We're given some graph. We want to find the some cut of this graph that minimizes the number of edges going around, across the cut as a fraction of the proportional to the cut size. So minimizes the ratio between the boundary and the volume. And that's an incredibly useful thing. It's, I don't even know all the places where it's used. Often you want to try to analyze, say, random walks, Markov processes, etc. You want to understand what are the obstructions from them, like from starting from a given point and reaching the entire space. A lot of divide and conquer algorithms work by splitting the graph into two pieces and working on each piece separately. So, you know, it's a very useful thing to have. And we have seen basically an approximation for that. So, if P of G is the minimum of number of edges divided by the expected number, which you can think of it basically if one of the sets will be smaller than size n over 2, so you can also think of it up to constant, it's the same thing as the number of edges from S to S to its complement times, you know, divided by the number of possible edges going out of S, which is the degree times the size of the S of the set. So we have seen basically Cheeger inequality gave us square root P versus P approximation. So that follows from Cheeger. But for some graphs, this could be terrible. For some graphs like the cycle or something like that, where the expansion is like 1 over n, this could be terrible. This could be maybe as bad as 1 over square root n or something. So like if you want to count the approximation value as the ratio between the expansion of the set you produce and the best set that was possible. So this can be very bad approximation ratio. And later in Rao gave an O of log n approximation algorithm, and this is we will see one. I mean, we will see one way how we can get a log n approximation algorithm. It's not very hard to get such an algorithm, but this algorithm has been very, very useful in lots of applications. And you might feel like log n is a natural bound for this problem, so it's a kind of a natural algorithm. You might think that maybe that's the optimal, so that's why people were very, very, very impressed when the result of Arora Rao and Vazirani, they gave an O of square root log n approximation algorithm. And beyond the fact that you know, they beat a natural bound, their techniques were, and especially the techniques of the analysis, were very different than things we have seen before, and that also makes it a very good algorithm to study, and particularly to study its analysis. So one disadvantage of the analysis is that it's not super simple.
And so see if I had to bring the printer this time, so kind of high tech. Works. So, so it's not super simple, but it, I think it's worthwhile to see. And I think Pritam said that on in Berkeley, in Luca Trevisan's course, he spent like 4 to 5 lectures on this analysis of the algorithm. So, you know, I guess that each lecture was like 1.5 hours or what? So, yeah, I guess like 7.5 hours. So basically we have 3 hours, but you guys are twice as smart as Berkeley students, so it works out.
Could you explain how the coffee
what?
The 2 minutes, how small they equal?
They are up to constants.
Oh, okay.
Up to constants. They're not equal exactly, but you can see, it's kind of an exercise to show that they're equal up to constants. Okay, so what is the ARV theorem? Rao Vazirani. So, so it's the following. Suppose that Xi is a degree 4 pseudo distribution over 0, 1 to the n. Such that let me make things slightly simpler. This is generally, it gives an approximation in anything. Let's just assume that the distribution pretends that there is a set of size exactly exactly n over 2, which is kind of slightly simpler. So the expectation of xi is half for I. So and the sum over I j in the graph, neighbors in the graph, the pseudo expectation of x I minus x j squared. This is basically the probability that the edge is cut is less than some number phi. Then there exists some set S, say of size most 0.99n, that's enough for what we need, such that the number of edges going from S to its complement is less than O square root log n d times the size. So, and actually give an algorithm to find this set S. So this gives you a square root log n approximation algorithm for the sparsest cut. Okay, we run the sum of squares algorithm, we find a degree for a pseudo distribution, we apply this theorem. Okay? So now, let's prove it. Okay, so the proof, by the way, that I present, in some parts will slightly deviate from the one in the notes. So, David and I kind of figured out yesterday maybe a way, what we think is maybe a slightly cleaner way to explain it. I hope it is also correct, and comments or suggestions are welcome. So we'll see how it goes. What? Yes. Yes, it's not very hard to find a set that has, you know, less than 2 times d times s. So yeah, the interesting case is right phi is smaller than 1/√ log n. Okay, so so really the whole
The whole proof of ARV is just one main lemma, and this is the following. Suppose we define age. So let's set delta to be something like some very small epsilon times 1 over, so some very small epsilon divided by square root log n. And suppose we define we define age to be this graph where, corresponding to when xi minus xj squared is smaller than delta. Then there exists and xi is j's are as above, and there exist a and b. Of size omega of n, such that for every that there is no edge in age between a and b. So this lemma says. You can take this. This graph. So not the original graph. You can take this. You can take this age graph, and break it. Find two parts that are not completely tiny, such that there are no edges between these two parts. And basically everything we are going to focus on is how to. How to prove this lemma. So, but we'll start by showing that this lemma actually implies the theorem that we want to show. Okay. So maybe the way I do it is I use this board to show why the lemma implies the theorem, and then move to proving the lemma. Would have been very nice if when I showed that the lemma implied the theorem, I would have not erased the theorem before, but hopefully we'll still manage. Okay, so why does the lemma imply the theorem? So what we do is the following. We're going to essentially what we're going to do is going to take we have this set A, we have this set B, and what we are going to do is take choose. We're basically going to do S will be something like some set that's some set that kind of contains A. It might even contain some parts of B, but so we're going to choose T at random in 0, 1. And we're going to choose T at random in 0, 1. We are going to then define st to be I such that there exists a j in A with expectation of xi minus xj squared smaller than t. Okay, so now let's look at what's the so So first of all, what do we know? So the expectation okay, so typical okay, so you want to keep this thing. Right, so for a typical age ij, we know that the expectation of xi minus xj squared is at most phi. Right? So now if you look at I and J, suppose that the closest, let's say that this is TI and this is TJ. TI is the distance from A and TJ is the distance is I's distance from A, the smallest guy that's close to I, and TJ is the distance of J from A. So what do we know about, suppose this value is phi, so what do we know about TJ minus TI? It's smaller than? Right? It's smaller than phi, right? Can you see it? Because if the you're basically looking at the probability that J, right? You want to look at the probability that say that you look at the closest guy. There is this guy here, some guy little a, such that the probability of these guys, these two guys, of being different, say, is at most TI, and the probability of these two guys, of these two guys being different is at most phi. So by the union bound, the probability of A and J being different is at most TI plus phi. So this is, if it was actual probabilities, for the Grifo, so the distribution, you have to prove that this thing behaves like actual probabilities. This is known as the squared triangle inequalities. So that's basically the only thing that ARV really uses about the Grifo pseudo distributions, rather than the Grifo. So maybe we should write it that expectation of xi minus xk squared is smaller than expectation of xi minus xj squared, expectation of xj minus xk squared. And the reason this works is because this is really the probability, if it was actual distribution, this is probability that xi is different from xk, is smaller than the probability that xi is different from xj, plus probability that if xi is different from xk, one of these events has to hold. Yes?
In the main lemma, is that a pseudo expectation or a real one?
Pseudo expectation, yes. Right, and that's really the only thing that we use. But actually, it turns out that the main lemma, we talk about it, it's not that much different to prove for expectation or pseudo expectations. In some sense, one way you can think of proving it is, but it turns out it's really the same, so the proof is not easier for actual expectation, but it's, it's really the same. So, okay, so basically what it means, right, so if we know that the difference here is at most phi, it means that when we choose a random t, the probability that we cut any particular edge is at most phi, right? So the expected number of edges cut is at most phi d, the total number of edges, and the expected size, right? The expected size of the set. So it's definitely is at least
Okay, so the set has definitely size. The set definitely has size at least omega of n, and there's also like these many guys that are sitting of distance at least delta apart. So the expected size of the set, or let's say the complement of the set, which might be the smallest guy. So just easier to. So the expected size of the set is at least delta n, delta is this thing. So if we look at the expected, if we, there will be some guy where the number of edges cut where like es s bar divided by the size of s, or maybe s bar, because s bar will be the guy small. Like EST, there will be exist some T such that ST is smaller, say, than N over ST bar is smaller than N over 2, and this will be at most, right, this will be at most, right, 1 over delta C, the size of the set. Okay, so this is phi dn, right? The total number of edges is phi dn, or dn over 2, doesn't matter. Okay?
So expectation of edges cut is other expectation
so,
of...
So the expected number of the edges cut, you take all over all edges, there are d times n edges, or dn over 2. And each one of them is cut with probability at most phi.
Uh-huh.
Or like on average, it's cut with probability.
So does that have anything to do with ST here?
Yeah, because T is random between 0 and 1.
Okay, so the procedure is you pick T and then you cut the edges with ST.
Right, you pick T and you, yeah, like the cut is ST and ST complement. So the cut cuts every edge, on average, the cut cuts a phi fraction of the edges, fraction of the edges. And the smallest side of the cut is at least, in expectation, at least delta n. So you're basically going to be, going to get, so there will be some t where this ratio is going to be at most 1 over delta times phi d, the size of the set.
So is this fat graph?
So this is the original graph. We are cutting the original graph, but we are looking at the sets that came to us from the previous graph. And the what we know about these sets is that when we pick t at random, then the expected size of the cut, you get at least the expected size of the say the smaller part of the cut is at least delta n, because you know there are like at least n guys that are delta far away, so with probability delta you get at least n. So we play a little bit here with the expectation, right? When we measure the expectation, we use the fact that we choose t at random. What we care about is at the end one particular t, but to prove that something exists, we only need to show that one t exists. So we are going. So it uses this. Thing that if you know that expectation that there always exists. So if you have random variable x and y, such that expectation of x divided by expectation of y is at least blah, then there is always some sample, even there is correlated random variables, there is always one sample of x and y that makes this at least blah. The probability that this is at least blah is positive. And so if we know that in expectation over t, the expected number of edges is cut divided by the expected size of the set is at most something, then there will be something where this is at most this. So is everybody clear on why the ARV main lemma implies the ARV theorem?
a good time to ask question. Yes?
You said the ARV provides an algorithm to find the cut?
Yes.
So, does this, how do we find the
cut? Ah, okay, so you can see that actually, like, I mean, I talked about T between 0 and 1, but you can see that basically because there are only n vertices, there are many, you really only care about n values of T. So so you can kind of enumerate over all of them, right? You can basically sort the vertices according to the distance from A and try all cuts, and one of them will work. Yeah, and of course you need the set A and B, but that's the ARV main lemma actually gives you the set. Okay, so we are, so basically what it means is that now we only need to prove the thing about the ARV main lemma, and one thing to remember is, when we prove the ARV main lemma, we forget about the original graph. We forget about the parameter phi. That doesn't matter anymore. All we need to prove is that if you have a graph defined on pseudo distributions, where you put an edge between two guys that are very close, then that graph is going to, and we are going to assume this thing. Just again, for the sake of convenience, we are going to assume that, say, expectation of xi, xi is half for all I. So it's kind of a pseudo distribution over balanced things. Then, because otherwise it could be that, you know, it could be like an actual distribution that is always identical, that these things are somehow, that the graph is the clique. But, so what you, now what you want to say is that this is that in this case, in any graph like that, so we can find a significant amount of kind of a large set A and a large set B, such that the probabilities of every guy in A and every guy in B are not close to each other. If a guy in A is in the cut, the probability that if a guy A is in the cut, the probability that they are both on the side of, on the same side of the cut is not too big. Okay. So maybe again somehow it's always a useful thing before we kind of show it something to understand. I mean, where does this square root log n come from? And so let's look at an example that shows that this growth log n thing is tight. So, and look at an example, you know, to give a proper example, let's look at an actual distribution. Okay, so I'll show you that there is an actual distribution where the square root n thing is tight. So here is the actual distribution. So the way I think about it is the following. Think of the set n as 2 to the l, okay? And the random variables, so the random variables are basically, now we think of them as x 0 to the n until x 1 to the n. And these are correlated random variables, and 1 to the l, sorry. So this is, maybe I should write it, this is example that ARV main lemma is tight. It doesn't show that you cannot do a better algorithm, but it shows that if you want to do better, you have to use a different lemma. So we're going to have an actual random variables. These are over, you know, 0, 1.
So that should be 0 L.
What?
Under X.
0 L, yes. Okay, right, so we want to show an actual set of random variables, and we are going to basically define how do we choose this random variable. We pick I at random in L, and basically XA is simply AI. Okay, so if you think about it, the expectation of, say, xA minus xB squared is really like the Hamming distance of A and B divided by L. Right, the probability that they differ is the fraction of coordinates in which they differ. Okay? So, and now we want to claim, okay, so now first of all, let's see, okay, so the air, so in our case, this delta is going to be, you know, let's say 1 over, I don't know, 100 square root log n. What is log n in this graph? Root L, right? Right, so 100 root L, right? So, what does it mean? That basically, in this graph, A is a neighbor of B if the Hamming distance of A and B is at most what? Someone else other than Greg, just want to make sure that everyone follows. So what's the Hamming distance? If A is a neighbor of B in this graph H, what's the Hamming distance of A and B? How many coordinates do they differ? Yes, right? 0.01 root L coordinates. Right, this is basically, so right, every random variable is indexed. Every random variable is indexed by a string. The random variable is just pick coordinates. So two random variables they differ with probability some probability delta. If they differ in delta L coordinates, so in our case this means they differ in 0.01 square root L coordinates. So now let me tell you what are the sets. In this case, so the sets in this case, if you here is sets, so I can take A to be all the A's such that sum of AI is less than L over 2 minus square root L, and B to be all the B's such that sum over BI is larger than L over 2 plus square root L. So right, so what's the Hamming distance between every two guys between A and B? Right, it's at least 2 square root L, right? So definitely there is no edge between them. And the measure of A and B, right, this is one standard deviation. A is everyone that has like one standard deviation. The sum is one standard deviation away, so it's a constant measure set and similar to B. So basically you kind of have, in this case, you kind of order things according to the sum, and this is L over 2, and you have your like minus square root L, plus square root L, and this is A, and this is B. And it turns out, I'll not prove it right now, but it's not hard to prove using some concentration inequality, so that we have here the isoperimetric phenomena. This is the best thing you can do in this cube. Every other set, every two sets of measure, if you take every two sets, say, one way to say it is the following thing. Here is a theorem, which I've not proved, though it's not super hard. If the size of A is at least, say, n over 100, n over 1000, then if you look at the set, A, let's call it A plus X, where the number of coordinates in X is at most, I don't know, 100 square root L. So if A has at least some non-negligible mass, this is actually going to be at least 0.999 m. So if A has some significant mass, if you look at everyone that's say 100 standard deviations away from it, you actually get everything. And And you can show this. This is basically concentration of measure, and a lot of the things what you can think of when you say about concentration of measure is that you have a phenomena of you either get nothing or you get everything. So here you basically say if you didn't get nothing, if A was kind of significant, then fudge it a little bit, and you get everything. That's something that kind of repeats itself again and again. And just know that this is some kind of an isoperimetric inequality. It says that the best way to get these separated sets is this nice geometric way. Okay, so this shows the ARV main lemma is tight, but of course it doesn't show that it's true. Maybe there is a different example. And this is basically what we are going to now show. We're going to prove the ARV main lemma. Okay, So we actually do know something else, but it might not seem this way from what I've talked so far, and it will not seem this way after this lecture, but we do have some other tricks. But what's the one trick that we have so far used for rounding super distributions? Quadratic sampling, right? So, you know, that's the first thing you do. You look at the super distribution, you always do quadratic sampling. Never hurts. So that's what we're going to do. So, and it sounds, so, so we are going to, so here is the proof. You're going to let Y, call it a Y1 and Yn be the Gaussians matching X1 Xn. So this is an actual distribution, the Y1 till Yn, which matches the moments of X1 till Xn. And now, this is somewhat maybe not surprising if you look at what we did above. We say A prime is, okay, maybe just for slight simplicity, let me, so we have that expectation of yi, okay. So if you had an actual Gaussian, so we'll be kind of normalized Gaussians. What do I mean by normalized Gaussians? You know, if you match xi, xn, your expectation should be half. Standard deviation should be half. Let's subtract the expectation and divide by the standard deviation. So expectation of yi is zero, expectation of yi squared. One. So everyone individually is like a standard Gaussian. Doesn't really matter much for you know what we are doing, just slightly more convenient notation. So we're going to find A prime to be I such that yi is less than minus one, and B prime to be, or maybe let's call it, I don't know, A such that ya is, and B is B such that yb is plus one. Okay? So these are sets of constant measure, right? No problem about that. And the first thing we try is to output those guys. That's great, but maybe we didn't really succeed. So we look at this graph H. And maybe there are a few edges between A prime and B prime. So what we do is we find some maximum matching M between A prime and B prime. And basically if M is less than, I don't know, N over 1000, then we are happy.
Right, because if we take the if we find the maximum matching, remove it, there are no more edges. There are no more edges between these two guys, right? Because if there was an extra edge, it would have been we could have added it to the matching. So we take the maximum matching between A prime and B prime, just remove it. If you know, A had like some, I don't know, n over 5, B was n over 5 or whatever. So so if we are if this maximum matching has size at less than n over 1000, then we are happy. And otherwise, we are sad. Okay, so basically, ARV main claim is you know, I don't know, with probability at least half, we are not sad. Matching can't be too big for a good fraction of the time.
So in here you're only using degree 2 to do this. So
yes.
I mean, you use degree 4 when you prove that the lemma is present here. But when here somehow the statement of the lemma is true only in degree 2.
No, no. So basically, notice that this property above. This property is true about the Gaussians as well, right? It's a property about the degree 2 moments that they satisfy this triangle inequality, but it's only true because they came, because these guys came from a degree 4 pseudo distribution.
But you're only using the Gauss.
Right, but the Gaussians still satisfy this property. Right, so. So you could state this main lemma as saying that if you have Gaussians that satisfy the square triangle inequality, then you can do it. So that's the only thing you use about degree 4 some squares in this book is this square triangle inequality, this property here.
But you're going to use that
for the Gaussians. For the Gaussians.
You're going to use this in the proof of the lemma?
Yes.
Or
yes. So we are going to use it in the proof of the lemma and we're going to use it inherently in the proof of the lemma. So, yes?
So, before you have the expectation of an xi minus xj squared is less than equal to delta, after you transform it to yi, what's the constraint now?
The expectation of, it's the same, because say expectation of xi was half, transforming it is really, you know, subtracting half, that doesn't change the expectation of xi minus xj, and you know, multiplying by 2 or quarter or whatever, that doesn't change it.
So it's constant.
Yeah, it's a constant, which we don't care about anyway. So, yeah, so it's the, normalizing is not really making any. Right, so basically, the ARV main claim is that you cannot have a large matching all of the time, and let me we'll prove the main claim after the break. But let me give you the outline of the proof. Or maybe let's start. Okay, let's do a warm up. Suppose delta was like 100 over log n, and you know, 1 over 100 log n. So suppose we wanted to get like a Layton Rao approximation. Then I claim that we wouldn't even need to we wouldn't even need to do this matching business. This original A prime and B prime would be good, because so what it means, like, so a bad edge AB will satisfy the following: the expectation of YI minus YA minus YB squared. So a bad edge will satisfy the following: the expectation of YA minus YB squared is less than delta, but the actual value, right? With some so the actual value happened to be at least 2, which is like 100 log n is that what I want to say? Happened to be 2, which is the way I should think of it is square root 100 log n square root delta. Why do I write it this way? Because this is a variable, this is a Gaussian variable, y a minus y b. It's a Gaussian variable with standard deviation delta. And now we say, what's the probability that it has to, that its value happened to be 2, right? For it to be bad, it has to be that one of them is on this side, one of them is on the other side, so the difference had to be at least 2. So what's the probability that a Gaussian random variable has k standard deviations, more than it should? It's like something like e to the minus k squared, right? So basically, the probability that for every particular a and b, the probability that a is bad, a b is bad, is less than, you know, I don't know, n to the minus 100, right? In this case, if delta is 100 log n. So we can do a union bound over all the n squared edges, so there will not be, with very, very high probability, there will not be even one pair that is bad. So we are done, we don't need the matching, nothing like that, right? So if we wanted just the log n, life would be easy. The problem is, what we want is delta, which is like 1 over 100 square root log n. And then, this probability of AB being bad is just basically something like, will basically be something like 2 to the minus, O of square root log n. So there might be bad guys. Probably there will be bad guys. What you want to somehow show is that, but potentially the a priori the graph could have had like n squared edges, right? So you could imagine, right, a priori, you could have n squared times, 2 to the minus of square root log n, which is larger than n to the 1.99 bad edges. So, well, you might, think, you look at this and you say, well, I'm probably screwed because why, if I had like n to the 1.99 edges, probably, every guy here will be connected to some guy here, and I'm not going to be able to make these far from each other. But somehow, so you kind of need a much more sophisticated probabilistic analysis to argue that this is still okay. And that's what we'll see after the break. So. So it's now 10:56. You can enjoy like a full 9 minute break at 11:05. Getting soft in old age.
Yeah.
Everything needs to be probabilistic, nothing geometric. Everything needs to be probabilistic. Okay, so I think we can. So this is the way we are going to. So we need to prove the ARV main claim that we are not sad, and
And the way we're going to do it is the following thing. So we have this graph age of everything, maybe just remind, say that, say I is connected to J if expectation of yi minus yj squared is less than delta. And now we define the following random variable. We define zit to be the maximum. So this is a random variable. So the maximum over j, which is of distance at most t to I in the graph. So j, there is a path of length at most t between j and I in this graph, such that the maximum of zj of yj minus yi. Okay? This is a non-negative variable, so of course y is connected to itself, j, I is connected to itself with distance 0. But you kind of look at the left, at all your neighbors t away, and you look how much can you grow this random variable, this yij value, and that's zid. So it's a random variable correlated with this yz. So for every choice when we sample y1 till yn, we get these random variables zit. Okay? And the main, so what we'll show is that as long as t is smaller than something like 1 over, I don't know, 1000 delta, then the sum from I from 1 to n expectation zit is going to be at least 0.01 t. And okay, and assuming and we assume that we are sad, right? We assume that we have this matching with decent probability. So we are going to show this, and this will actually conclude the proof. The reason, maybe I should write it 1 over n. So this will conclude the proof, because what it will mean is that if we set t to be, you know, we set delta to be something like, right, we set delta to be something like epsilon square root log n, then what it will mean is the following. We set t to be epsilon over we set t to be epsilon what we need to be right epsilon over square root okay, I'm getting confused, 1 over 1000 1 over 1000 epsilon square root log n, then we get that there exists at least one I. So there exists an I such that expectation of zit is at least this thing, is at least like square root. If epsilon is small enough, is at least say 100 square root log n. Right. So there will be, so in expectation it means that there will be some I. There will be some I such that in some t, so that from the, if you go from I to distance t, you can get
you can get to a difference of hundreds square root log n. But we have just argued before that this event never happens. Even if you can go over all the graph and look all pairs in this graph, you will never find a pair that is of difference more than you know, two square root log n or something. Why did I say that? I guess because right. So just to make sure, why do I say that? Because then we know that expectation of yj minus yi squared, it's always at most one, right? You know, it's or two or whatever. Like it, the standard deviation, you know, the standard deviation of this is at most constant. So you cannot be 100 square root log n standard deviations away. Okay? Is it clear? So basically, this is really the heart of the matter. If we show this, right? So we want to show that the expected, right? So we want basically to show that as you take t steps, as long as t is not too big, as you take another t steps, you increase the expected gap between two guys. Okay. So. So this is what we want to show, and let's start by assuming the case that you know, the matching, like say with some probability you get the perfect matching, just like so the matching is you know, some perfect matching in the graph from, you know, left to right, kind of partitions everything say equally, So you assume that with some probability you get matching left to right, so such that for every I in left and j in right, so for every I say for every I in left, z y m I minus y, it's a one-to-one mapping, y m I minus y I is at least whatever it is, one, two, doesn't matter. Okay, so we assume that we are sad. That means that with some probability we get, it's actually a partial matching, just for starters I think of it as a perfect matching. So with some probability we get this matching, which basically tells us you know, we split these guys into left and right. And we get you at least one. So that means that if this is yi, there is if you go to m of I, you can increase it, this value y of m of I is you can increase this value by one. Right, so this is a probability. Notice this matching is a random variable. For every choice of this y1 till yn, we get a different matching. And maybe with some probability we don't get the matching at all. But with some, say, constant probability, we do get the matching. Okay? So we want to prove this kind of thing by induction. So we want to prove that I from 1 to n yit, say 1 over n, is larger than 1 over n, in expectation, 1 over n sum I from 1 to n yit minus 1 plus something, 0.01. Right. This is what we want to prove. And that in expectation, we are going to grow. And the key property we want to use is the following.
if in t steps here, you know, if in t steps here you can get, if in t steps, t minus one steps, you can get to, you can go from this, so you can increase your value by some number row, then you can, if there is this matching, you can increase this value by one more, right? In t steps, you can go one more and then this additional row. And because it's a matching, these guys are basically uniformly distributed. There is no, so basically this should be basically the expectation, the same as the expectation. But let's do be more careful, because you do need to be more careful, otherwise you can prove something that's actually wrong. So let's try to basically use this thing. So what we're going to say is the following. We're going to say the following. The expectation of yi.
Okay. Define y.
What?
What do you mean z?
What?
Y sub I equal t.
Ah, it should be z. It should be z. Z. Sorry. We want to prove z. Z. Right. So we want to look at right. So we want to say the following thing. So we want to say that. Right, the expectation of so we're going to sum so we're going to sum up
form on the right. Are you supposed to have an expectation with respect to expectations?
Yes, expectation. Yes. Yes. Thank you. So what we know is the following, right? So we know the following. So we know that if we sum over I in the left z I t, this is at least and let's say this is a perfect matching t over 2 over n. This is at least 2 over n times the sum over basically I in the right z I t minus 1 right plus 0.0 or I guess in this case it's plus 1, right? So for every choice of the random variable, when we have this matching, we have this thing. Okay? So now we are going to basically take expectation. So when we take expectation, we are going to say the following thing. We are going to say the following thing. Sum from I 1 to n expectation of y z I z I t condition on I being in the left. What? Right, so this is basically we simply sum up right, we sum up this inequality. Right, so we know that if wait, what's the right way? Right, so we know that z I you know that basically z I t is larger than ZMI t minus 1 plus 1. Because you can always go from, if you want a length t path to increase the maximum, you can always go to this guy, add 1, then take the t minus 1 path and add whatever this adds.
So we know that this is true, and we basically add it up over all the guys in the left, and because it's a matching, this sums up over all the guys in the right, so we get this inequality. Right. So basically, we can say that if we sum up, for every I, we take the probability that it's left, and then condition on that, we get this ZIT. This is larger than 1 over n, sum over I plus 1 n, expectation, ZI T minus 1, probability that I is right, plus 1. Okay? Or maybe probability that this matching actually exists, which if it's not one, then in expectation, let's say, whatever the probability is, like some constant. What?
Where's the figure?
Yeah. So I'm just summing up, if you want, maybe it's half. Okay. Let's say 110.
Okay.
So we basically sum up this probability, and we just say we look at the guy. What's the probability of a guy participating in this inequality? So we basically are going to sum this up. And now the key property is that let's assume it's a perfect matching. So first of all, you can see that this matching is going to be completely symmetric because these random variables A and B are. You have the exact same probability of being of y b minus y a, and these are all symmetric. So the probability of being in the left is the same as probability of being in the right. So with probability half you're in the left, and say probability half you're in the right. So you basically can sum up all this overall, and you get this thing. The only problem could be that. Maybe when you condition on this event that you happen, I mean, in some sense, if you think about it, when you condition on this event that you happen to be on the right side, it means that you're kind of farther to the right, maybe you have less to go. So maybe the problem, it could be the problem what we want. So this is what we have. And what we want is the same. What we want is the same without conditioning. We want sum I from 1 to n, 1 over n, expectation ZIT larger than 1 over n, sum I from 1 to n, expectation ZIT minus 1. Plus 1 over 10, right? So if you could basically get this, what we want is this thing without conditioning on being on the left or being on the right. Agreed? So then, nice thing is, as happened before in this course, we can again stand on the shoulders of giants for this. And the crucial observation, right? So again, what we said before is we take for every I, we know that we basically sum up this this thing, and then we get this probability, and what we so you basically can say, you can think of this probability at above. You can maybe multiply it by probability of I being left, but this is half always. So probability of I being in the left is equal to the probability of the I being in the right. So what you can think of is that you're above here, you're summing up you're summing up for every I, sum I z
I T one left I is larger than one over n or two over n, doesn't matter. I from 1 to n zi t minus 1 taking t minus 1 byte I plus half and then basically this is up to scaling with this probability of being in the left or being in the right, which it's the same probability being in the left and being in the right. And it's a constant. So up to scaling that, then you get this inequality. Okay, you take expectation and you get this inequality. Right, this is the probability. Right, this is the expectation of this condition of being left. If you multiply by the probability of being in the left. Okay, so. So basically, if we manage to just make this conditional, if we just manage to make these conditional expectations be the same as the unconditional expectations, then we would be done. But just notice that intuitively the correlations work against us. When you are so basically, what is ZIT? ZIT. Is how much more you can go, you know, in these steps, how much farther more you can go to the right, how much you can increase your value. And when you kind of know that you're in the right, it's probably correlated with ZIT being a little bit smaller because you have less to go. Right? So the correlations are against us, but the question is how bad can they be? And now come the important part, and this is the following thing. That right. Let's. What is Z I T? It's the maximum, all right. Let's write over J of distance T to I of Y J minus Y I. Right. Each one of those is what kind of variable is Y J minus Y I? Gaussian, right? And what do we know? We know its standard deviation, it's as expectation zero, and its standard deviation, yj minus yi squared, is less than t delta, right? Because of this triangle inequality. And this is less than one, much less than one, because we chose t to be significantly smaller than one over delta. And now, it turns out that if you have a collection of Gaussians that might be correlated in some weird way, which you don't even know. So you have a collection, and you don't even know how many of those there are. So you have just some collection, psi t for some, t is a bad notation. Psi, I don't know, psi j for some j in some index set of j. And these are partially possibly correlated in some way. Then the name of this, does anyone know what the name of this is? So this is actually a well-studied concept, and it's known as Gaussian processes. And let me just state the fact that we need, and maybe Pablo can say a little bit then about why we care about these Gaussian processes, even if you don't care about ARV. But the main cool fact about Gaussian processes is that, and that's the only fact we need, is that if the maximum of expectation of psi j squared is much smaller than one, then the probability that the supremum of psi j, you know, the supremum differs from its expectation, from the expectation of the supremum, that it differs by more than, I don't know, 1 over 10,000 is little of 1. And that basically is enough for us, because basically what it means is that this event up there, that reconditioning on this event of being in the left, it's event that happens with probability, with a constant probability, then it cannot affect, conditioning on this event cannot shift the expectation by too much, because the probability that because the probability that you shift the expectation more by more than 1,000 is little of one. So conditioning on an event. So if you have a Gaussian, so if you have a Gaussian process with constant standard deviation, if you condition on an event that happens with sub-constant standard deviation, if you condition on an event that happens with constant probability, you cannot shift back the expectation by more than sub-constant. And that's, so basically, conditioning can change things by some additive little O of one. It's not going to matter, so we are still going to get, you know, maybe not 1 over 10, but we'll get, you know, 1 over 20. So, and this is known as concentration of measure for Gaussian processes, but maybe I wanted Pablo maybe to say a little bit about why we care about Gaussian processes regardless, because he knows about this more than me. And
I mean, let me just write a couple of things. Yes. I mean, there's, I guess, a number of reasons why, you know, one cares about this kind of Gaussian processes, but one of the, at least most important ones in optimization is it allows you to understand solutions of random optimization problems. Right, so you know, when quite often you want to write, for instance, essentially what you have is something of the following form. So if you want to maximize, for instance, some random linear function over x in some set, right? So what we have in here is g is a random variable, it's a random vector. I have a random cost function on, and I'm optimizing this random cost function over some set S. And you know, typically we want to understand, for instance, the expectation. Things about the situations you were concerned before with trying to understand the maximum of random polynomial. Right? That you would essentially it's exactly something of this type. And the point is there's very, very strong concentration results. I mean, I guess we saw an example on these kind of problems. But also one of the nicer things of Gaussian processes is that there's a very nice and very intrinsic geometry associated to this. So for instance, one of the facts that I think many of you may know is that if I have n Gaussian random variables, let's say standard random variables, then what's the maximum, or what's the expected value of the maximum of the x sub i's? You guys should know this. Sorry? It's like square root log n, right? And somehow in here, the number of random variables appears explicitly, the x of y's. But it turns out that even if I have an infinite number of random variables in here, as long as I understand somehow the covariant structure, the infinite covariant structure, if you want, of my matrices, then we can give in here a bound that depends somehow on the intrinsic geometry of these random variables. And there's beautiful techniques. I mean, you may have heard things like chaining, but that allows you to bound exactly this kind of functions. So it's a beautiful topic. It appears all over the place. If you've heard about, for instance, compressed sensing or all this matrix completion stuff, there's a very natural way by which Gaussian processes appear in there and can allow you to bound all kinds of things that you want. So
really the thing that we use here is that we don't really know what the degree of, how many guys like that we have. There could be as many as n of them. It's not something we can kind of do union bounds, etc. But this, thinking of it as a Gaussian process, we say, whatever the maximum is, and the maximum, the actual value of the maximum will differ based on the geometry of these random variables, the correlation structure. So the actual maximum, what is actually this maximum, is not clear. It's hard to compute, but it will be concentrated. Whatever the value is, it will be concentrated around this value within a plus minus little of one additive term. And this is enough, basically, at this point we are done. And when the matching is not perfect, it doesn't really matter, because you still have a constant probability of being on the left or on the right, the possibly one clean way to think about it is that you kind of match a vertex to itself with some probability, and when you match it to itself, then you only get you know, zero. You don't get any advantage, but you will still get, like, on average, a constant improvement. On average, the matching will contribute like a constant improvement. So and you can still do the same thing. Yes.
Sorry, first question. So what are these like images?
Right. So these zeta j's are simply yj minus yi, right? So zi, what we want to say is that zi t for every t and every I is always a Gaussian process with the maximum of its variance or maximum standard deviation little of one. And that's the only thing we care about it. We say it's some Gaussian process with little of one, and that means. Right, so let me maybe do it explicitly. So in particular, that means that you know, probability that expectation of ZIT condition on some arbitrary event A, if the, you know, if the probability of A is at least a constant, then the expectation of this condition on A minus the expectation of the unconditional expectation is little of one. And the reason is that the probability that even if A kind of tried to be the worst possible thing and kind of put all its mass on when Zi deviates from the expectation, it wouldn't matter because it can only increase the deviation by a constant factor. So basically, this is you can use this factor to say this is a Gaussian process. And notice that basically that's why we need that we cannot take t to be too long, because we need the standard deviation to remain little of one. So we basically and we use the triangle inequality and here in a crucial way. So this is we use the triangle inequality here in a crucial way, right? So we said that because j is of distance at most t to I, the variance only grows like t delta. By factor, the variance only goes by a factor of t, or the standard deviation only goes by a factor of square root t. So, and in some sense, if you think about it, the fact that the standard deviation grows by a factor of square root t instead of t, that's really the reason why we managed to go from log n to square root log n.
Where else does the concentration measure for soup occur?
Like in other in what
like areas? Other like processes or
something. So I mean, I think many of the times when you analyze, like it's exactly what Pablo said, like that's exactly often what you want to ask. You know, if you're looking at if you're thinking of maximizing g x where x is in some set X, you can think of it as basically you define the random variable Gaussian chi, right? So you're looking really at the maximum, right? You're looking at this really, like where G is kind of a random Gaussian. So what you're really looking at is like a collection chi X for X in X of Gaussian variables. And you want to know what is the maximum going to be.
So, Pablo, I think I kind of remember something like this from martingales. Is there something for martingales?
Typically for martingale, you need some kind of ordering of your
right,
process.
Right, right. I think
here you don't, right? I mean,
yeah,
you just
yeah,
consider
yeah.
this as a...
But I think sometimes people think of Gaussian processes that are indexed by the index set. You think of it as a time, and so these people, if you search for Gaussian processes, you see this kind of
you can want to add around, I mean, that's a beautiful book.
Yeah, so there is like they really appear a lot of tons of places, and in some sense the nice thing, the nice thing about them is that somehow they give a general way to think about this thing, which if you try to look at it, it could like look dauntingly complicated. You have these Gaussians, you don't know exactly their structure, and this is exactly the case here. So a priori, we maybe wouldn't have expected that we could save over log n, because we could say, well, all we can do is this union bound. And some of these, this allows you to take advantage of this structure.
And that is perhaps, I think, one of the most important messages, right? That you know, for instance, in the example I was saying, there's a bounded maximum of n thousands.
Right.
I mean, the point is anything that you try to do that's based on union bounds or arguments of this type, you have this dependence on n. But in certain situations, because you understand the correlation structure, you get bounds that are actually independent of n. And that's exactly, I think, the case.
Right. So here, like again, we have no dependence on the degree of the ground. Like how many guys? We have no idea how many guys are of distance t to I, and we don't care. And so that's kind of a very useful thing to know. And the actual, like I said before, like the to compute the actual value of the maximum, that will depend both on the number of guys and the and the way it's structured, but yeah. With the deviation, we can be fine.
And in the end, it ends up depending on geometric properties of the I mean, there's a geometric space that you can associate somehow to your random variables, and it really depends on the intrinsic geometry.
Yes.
Think about the covariance.
I don't know if this question makes any sense at all, but like, does that have connections? Like, is there a Gaussian process interpretation of like Sauer-Schala or like
I don't know. Yeah, maybe that doesn't make sense.
Is there a question there? Or? Yes?
So I know you said that this is more like the geometric bounds that you get that are independent of the number of Gaussians, but mm-hmm. It just so happens that here we get a square root log n, and there we also get a square root. Is that related?
I don't know.
I guess to some extent what you can say is that these kind of bounds of Gaussian processes maybe allow you to say, you know, you have this collection of Gaussians, you can understand what happens if they are all kind of perfectly correlated, if they are all independent. And I think in this case, maybe, I don't know exactly how these guys, this is also not a description of ARV like you would see in their paper, but maybe to some extent you can say that you get optimistic because you initially try to do some guesses and say, you know, if everything was independent, we would be fine and we'll get this growth again for one reason. And if everything was correlated, we would be fine and we'll get something maybe even better than growth again for another reason. And then the thing is that somehow these bounds kind of allow you to talk about this, you know, to get some general thing that just works for all cases. But so in this case, the actual maximum does depend on n, and we do get this. And I think the square root log n really comes from this condition here. You cannot, once you go, once you increase this thing too much, then you suddenly, the standard deviation becomes bigger, and then you cannot you don't have this concentration bound anymore. And this might seem like something very technical, and maybe you can get around it if I haven't shown you before an example that this lemma is actually tight. So so this basically concludes the proof of ARV. I guess we did this in 2 hours. Don't worry, I thought we don't need the whole 3 hours for something like that. Next, we're going to talk about whether ARV is tight and what kind of examples do we know, what evidence do we know whether we can improve it beyond that or not. But before I go to that, and before the break, know, this is your chance to ask questions about the proof or other questions. So this version, I mean, there is a proof written in lecture notes. It's slightly different language. This version will probably be there in a couple of days. And but I'm really happy to answer any question now. Is everyone clear why, at least, maybe you didn't follow every line, but why we are basically done if we're... So, yeah, by the way, that other proof in which I was messed up in the lecture notes is by now already fixed, this CSV thing from last lecture. So,
just a question,
yes.
Like about if you were like trying to prove this theorem, you try to solve it for the first time, like all these constants, do you just like tweak them like by hand until they work?
So, I mean, the way kind of these kind of constants, and one kind of way that David wrote this proof in the notes, which is not completely kosher but makes things cleaner, is he never writes explicit constants. He always uses O and omega, and then basically you have to check at the end that the dependence on the constants is acyclic. but it is. So you can. So one way to think about it is, you know, just say if something is a constant, just call it a constant, and that's it. Another way, by the way, which often is a useful heuristic. Whenever you see in whenever you see O of F, think of it as a million times F, and whenever you see omega of F, think of it as F over a million. And just imagine this: whenever you see an O and omega, and whenever you see the other thing also, if you see a constant that is kind of larger than one, call it an O, smaller than one, call it an omega. And most of the time, it will work out fine. And like I said before, I'm kind of a big fan of non-type safe notations. Okay, so basically, after the break, what we are going to do is after the break, what we are going to do is talk about whether ARV is tight and what do we know about this question. So we made good pace. Did go all the way to 11 minutes. That seems like wow, so luxurious. Wow, so, can take 11 minutes break, don't spend it all in one place. Okay, so I think we can start, and I wanted maybe to start by, just because this kind of is was a long proof, and you might be, losing the forest for the trees, or whatever the right metaphor is. So so let's just kind of remind ourselves. So at least if you didn't understand thing a point, you kind of know where that point that you didn't understand was in the grand scheme of things. So basically the way it worked is the following. We wanted O of square root log n approximation for expansion, for the expansion, and then we showed that this is enough to find A and B that are well separated. So we showed that this is it's enough to find A and B that are well separated, in the sense that expectation of xA minus xB squared is larger than 1 over 1000 square root log n for all A, A in A and B in B. So, and that was the way we did that, is with this region growing argument, where we selected a random t and we looked at all the guys that are distance t from a. Okay, so that's so that was what we call the ARV main lemma, to find now A and B that are well separated. And then basically we sampled these Gaussians, and we show so then we show that to find A and B that are well separated, we want to show that there is no large matching. There is no large matching of stretched edges. So what is stretched edges? It means that we sample y1, yn using quadratic sampling lemma, and then we say that an edge is stretched if yj minus yi is it larger than 1, but expectation of yj minus yi squared is smaller than delta. So basically what we want to say is the only reason we fail in some sense is when we sample y1 to yn, always it's the case that we get a very large matching that basically kills all that touches all the vertices or almost all of the vertices. And so that's really the bad case, that this was kind of a bad matching. And again, the reason was that we did this quadratic sampling lemma, and if we kind of sort now things, we basically select for every vertex a number, a Gaussian, and we sort things. So we said, okay, this is the set A, this is the set B, like things that are smaller than minus one, things that are smaller than plus one. And the bad cases were like there was an edge between A and B. So there was these guys that were, even though their expectation of yj minus yi squared is at most delta, they happened to get like a distance 2 or 1, whatever, in this graph. So that was, so then it basically says, it reduced our case to show that there are no large matchings. And then what we showed is that okay, and then basically what we showed is the following. So notice so basically large matching, that's kind of immediately implies that on average, in one step, can grow by omega of one. Right, that's basically on average, if you take a random vertex and you ask by how much, if I went to my neighbor that's farthest away to the right, by how much I could grow. So if there is a large margin, then a large matching, then with some constant probability you will be on the left side of this matching and you can go to the right side and increase yourself by one. So large matching means that on average in one step you can grow omega of one. And then basically we wanted to show that and then this is basically where we use Gaussian process concentration in some sense to show that as long as t is not too big, and plus the triangle inequality, so that on average in t steps we can grow omega of t. So this is where we get this potential function of how much on average can we grow if we take t steps. And we show that on average, and the two things we used is that because of this triangle inequality or triangle squared inequality, that maybe that's not delta we use it, so let me call twice squared inequality. So because of this final squared inequality, the standard deviation doesn't grow by too much when we do this, and then we can use concentration bounds for Gaussian processes, and then we argue that on average in t steps you grow omega of t.
And then basically for t equals some, you know, some number, some whatever that number was, like some number which I guess was like 1/100 delta, which turns out to be the way we chose things would be like something like, I don't know, 1000 square root log n, then that would be a contradiction. And the reason is that these random variables all have, you know, for every I and j, yi minus yj squared is at most 1 or 2, and so it has constant standard deviation. So by a union bound, if we go over all n squared pairs, there will never be a pair like with very high the probability that there will be a pair that's so different is very small. So that's basically the blueprint of the proof.
What was the role of ZTI?
Of the what?
ZTI.
So ZTI was the growth, right? This was right. So 1/n sum I from 1 to n was kind of our potential function. ZIT is the, that was basically the average growth in t steps. Right? So we proved by induction that every additional step gets you another constant, like at least, you know, 0.01. As long as you don't take t to be too big, so that you can still use concentration.
So what is that predict?
What?
What is that predict?
Right. So we did it for t steps, and eventually we managed to show that after t, which is roughly 1/100 delta, which is like 100,000 times square root log n, the way we chose it, you actually get that. So the contradiction was that we proved that with some probability. That is at least, say, with some probability that is, say, constant, or there exist some I and J such that YJ minus YI is larger than 100 square root log n. Right, because if you can grow in t steps, in particular, the mass exists two pairs. But this is a Gaussian random variable with standard deviation constant. So the probability of this happening is something like, you know, n to the minus 100 or something like that. And you can do a union bound over all pairs ij. This will not happen. So this is a contradiction. Okay, so. So if we were willing to live with a log n approximation, we could have just taken one step, and you know we wouldn't have need to talk about Gaussian processes. Could just talk about Gaussians, and life is much simpler. But basically, with Gaussian processes and this triangle inequality, it allowed us to kind of stretch the bound until we get a contradiction. Okay, so this is the overall picture of this proof.
So is the assumption that matching is large only come in at the end?
No, so assumption that matching is large gives us the way it worked. It gave us that on each step, it gives us, you know, if the matching kind of has, say, fraction 1/10 of the vertices, it tells us that at every step, we get like 1/10. We can, if we take one extra step, so the crucial thing was with the matching, we say the following. If from j, you know, in t minus one step, this is yj, you can go to some yk, so that yk minus yj is some value rho, and now I is matched, like I is on the left, j is on the right, so the I is matched. Match to J, this means that there is at least one here, then clearly you can, then clearly it means that ZIT
is at least rho plus one. Right? So on average, if you know every I gets matched like a constant fraction of the time, then on average, in step, what you can do in t steps is, you know, some constant more than what you could do in t minus one steps. And that's.
So that use the matching is large.
Yes, that use that the matching is large because you know every edge like that gives you an. You want to say that on average you get a.
Oh, okay.
So you want to say that every vertex is
okay, yeah.
matched with some you know.
Yeah.
Next, on average, every edge is vertex is actually matched with some constant probability. Yes.
Did you also use for like the on top probability A is some constant?
Right, so then, right, yes, so yes, so we use the matching is large, okay. We used, so there are two cases, when we used the fact that it's actually, right, so we wanted to use the fact that it's not just some kind of large collection of edges, but it's actually a matching to argue that you know the left side will be like significant, so you can condition on that, and also that. You know, because it's a matching, we can when we sum up overall thing, every guy appears once. So when we measure progress by the total progress we make over all vertices. So we wanted to make sure that when we sum up over all I on the left side, then we also sum up over all j on the right side. So we kind of used maybe twice the fact that it's not just a collection of, say, n edges, but it's a collection that is a matching. So that's, yes?
To make sure I understand what we're saying, so we could phrase this without contradiction by saying that if there exists a matching, then there exists some pair ij with yj minus y out of the gate, and that means that it can only happen with some very low probability.
Yeah, so we could say, okay, so I think the way we it's a little bit delicate to say this because we somehow use it's kind of very useful for us that our potential function is this expectation. So we kind of don't prove a theorem that say so generally like say if you just take a matching. You know, it's a matching, there is no length t path in this matching, there's no length 2 path in this matching, it's just a matching. But we kind of want to say that because the matching exists with decent probability, there will actually be a way to improve on the length t path. So it's a little bit more delicate than that, and it's kind of very useful for us to think of this potential function as like the average improvement. Rather than say the improvement in this particular sample of the random variable. So if you go over this proof, it's kind of the thing that we want to try to remember is what is when do we take expectations and when do we look at the random variables that are actually based on you know the actual sample thing that we sampled. So the matching is probabilistic. The z i's are probabilistic, and then we kind of take expectations. So that's the high level of the proof, and now I want to talk a little bit about whether it's tight. So in fact, even before ARV came up with their algorithm, it was actually already people already realized that. These triangle inequalities could be potentially useful for that could be potentially useful for this kind of problem, and in fact, so Gomez and Linial
they made the following conjecture even before the ARV paper. I don't remember exactly when, maybe 97 or something. I'm not sure exactly when they made this conjecture, but they made the following conjecture. They say that the way we would phrase it, it's not exactly the way they phrase it, but they said if Xi's are degree 2 pseudo distribution that satisfies triangle square inequality. So triangle square inequality, so Xi is a degree pseudo distribution over 0, 1 to the n, and that satisfies the degree 2 triangle square inequality, that means it satisfies this thing that, this thing that the pseudo probability of Xi different from Xk is smaller than the pseudo probability of Xi different from Xj, plus the probability, pseudo probability of Xj different than Xk. So when I write pseudo probability, you can think of the expectation of Xi minus Xj squared. But if it was actual probabilities, it would be, you can see why it would be true. So this was like the triangle squared inequalities. Then what they conjecture is that there exists actual Boolean. There exists actual Boolean yi's such that a probability that yi different from yj, like that for every I and j, probability that yi different from yj is, you know, between, I don't know, one, some constant. They didn't really specify the constant, like some constant c, so just write c, and the pseudo probability that xi different from xj. So they made the following conjecture, and if this conjecture is true, you can see that you get a constant factor approximation for the expansion. And the way, by the way, this conjecture is usually phrased is that, I'm not going to explain all this notation, but the way that people will typically say it is that there is a way to map the metric space L2 squared, which is the kind of space satisfying this, of pseudo distribution satisfying these triangle inequalities, into L1, which is a space of where you have a distribution of a Boolean variables and the distance and the difference between distribution of a cuts and the distance between I and J is the probability that they are cut. So I think that's kind of the way that people will, if you look at Gomez-Williamson's linear conjecture, that's typically the phrase. But basically they conjectured that this is true up to a constant. It was known that it is true up to log n. There is kind of very general, basically we have seen it. It's not, I think, given what we have seen, it's an exercise for you, but it's a good exercise. Prove it. So here is an exercise. Prove for c equals log n. So then ARV came in 2004, and they showed that you can do it with C, you know, not a constant, but basically C equals square root log n. By the way, maybe I'm missing some references here. I don't know if ARV exactly proved exactly this statement. There might have been some other follow-up work that actually got this exact statement. So now there is this philosophy that that square root log n is not a proper quantity. What does it mean, square root log n? Like either it's log n or constant. What is like square root log n is not like a gentleman-y kind of approximation factor. So you could say that ARV was like evidence that maybe Gomez lineal were right and it is a constant. But then, basically, it turned out I think this is Raghavendra, Shtore, and Tulsiani, that they showed that, I don't remember when it was. Let's give some number, 11, I don't know. standard deviation here is like 2 years. So they showed that if this conjecture, small set expansion hypothesis, you can think of it as like some version of the unique edge conjecture. It implies that there is no constant factor approximation for expansion. In fact, they show that the Chigger thing is like in some range also the Chigger thing is optimal, but basically there is no. Yeah, and by the way, also here, like maybe I'm not remembering exactly all the references and everyone who did what, but let's put it this way. So basically, this predicts if this means that if this small set expansion hypothesis is true, then these two things contradict. One of them must be false. Either Gorman's lineal or the small set expansion. At least one of them must be false. Either Gorman's lineal or the small set expansion hypothesis. So basically, so now that you have a prediction like that, you can try to derive an integrality gap from this prediction. And this is what Kot and Bishnoi did. They basically took an integrality gap for a small set expansion and got from it basically an integrality gap for a sparsest cut. And in particular, they show that Gorman's lineal conjecture is false. And in particular, it was even more impressive. So this follow-up paper to RST11, they did it in 2004. So the history is actually a little bit backwards. They didn't know of the small set expansion hypothesis. But they basically showed that they could almost get unique games hardness for. So basically, the way they did it, they showed that they could almost get unique games hardness for this sparsest cut. And they couldn't exactly get unique game hardness, but they could show that they could use these ideas to basically get an integrality gap and therefore contradict this Gorman's linear conjecture. But somehow, what logically, if they had known about the small set expansion hypothesis, the order of things should have been this way. You first get hardness, then you use this general principle that hardness predicts an integrality gap, and you use the integrality gap. So now there is a question of, you know, if you believe this small set expansion hypothesis, so it's causing the unique edge conjecture, then you believe that basically it does not matter, like you should get also an integrality gap, not just for pseudo distributions satisfying the triangle inequalities, but also for pseudo distribution with you know, degree 100, million, I don't know, log n or whatever. So there is a question whether the Kot-Bishnoi integrality gap works for a degree, say, 100. So the distribution. And it turns out that the answer to this is no. And this is a paper that I wrote with Brandau, Howard, Kellner, Stowe, and Zhu in 2012. But it's also in some sense no in an interesting way. And let me kind of just give a high level without the full proof of why the answer here is no. So basically, the bottom line is that we know that the Gorman's lineal conjecture is false. If we believe this small set expansion hypothesis, then we believe that there should be an integrality gap, even for showing, say, super constant, even for, say, degree 100 super distributions. We don't know an example of such an integrality gap showing even super constant for degree 100 pseudo distribution. We also don't know, even using degree 100, to do anything better than square root log n. So,
Sorry, one question. There was also this example, I mean, James Lee showed that just a Kaiser method, right?
Right, right. So later, right, so later after this work, I think James Lee and Asaf Nahor, and they actually showed, for the Gomez-Linhas conjecture, they showed that it's really tight, like Skrout log n is the right answer here. So if you just want triangle inequality, you cannot get better than Skrout log n. But for degree 100, say, pseudo distributions, we don't know. Maybe you can get log n to the power 1 over 100. Maybe, you know, maybe you don't get anything better than Skrout log n. We really don't know. And it's a great question. So let me say a little bit of, this part will be kind of very high level, or how this integrality gap works. So this was, I think, maybe the first paper called Vishnoi that really, really used this approach of basically getting interesting integrality gaps through hardness, or at least more explicitly. So the integrality gap really looks like a hardness reduction in the following sense. They take, they didn't exactly think of it this way, but you can think of it the following sense. They can kind of take some integrality gap for a small set expansion, which I'll explain in a second what it means. They, you know, they compose it with some gadgets. So they do some gadget reduction. They replace each piece by some gadget, which is actually pretty similar to the gadget we've already seen. And then they argue that because it's a reduction, in this graph there was no small set that doesn't expand. In this graph there is no set period that doesn't expand. So this is the soundness. And the completeness is how you can pretend that there is a set. There is a non-expanding small set, where pretend means a pseudo-distribution. And the completeness here means that you can also pretend here that there is a set of, say, size at most half the vertices that doesn't expand. And the notion of doesn't expand also changes. And I'm not going to show the details of this this reduction. What I want to say is that the point in some sense is to try to understand, to try to understand why if this reduction gives you, so this reduction showed that the Gomez-Linhas conjecture is false, but you could ask if it also gives an integrality gap for the green 100 sum of squares. And it turns out that to understand this thing, what you really want to focus is on this soundness proof. And the point is the following. At the end of the day, this soundness proof tells you the following thing. It tells you something like, you know, if it tells you if the sort of the objective of the original instance is small, that's soundness, right? If the objective of the original instance is small, then the objective, it's an objective for a different problem, but the objective for a different problem, okay, this is a minimization problem maybe, so you're trying to minimize expansion, so if the objective is okay, let's call it bad. It's not so good. You cannot. It's bad. You don't have a good solution. Then the objective value for the reduction applies to the instance is also bad. Right. That's kind of soundness. That's what you want to prove in soundness. And then it turns out that this proof, the kind of the components that this proof used in the, for Kot-Bishnoi, they used hyperconductivity, which I'll say what it is. And they use something, this invariance principle that we have seen, which itself also relies also on hyperconductivity. And it turns out that these guys, or at least some good enough approximation of them, they have, you know, I don't know, degree 10 sum of square proof. At least good enough approximation for DSP. And what it means is the following. So if so what it means is, right, so soundness proof, one way to say what a soundness proof is it's a transformation in this direction. It takes a solution X here, and it makes a solution X prime here, right? So it says, if you have a solution that shows, demonstrate that this guy is not so bad, then you have also a solution that demonstrates the original guy was not so bad. But basically, if you have a degree 10, but basically what happens is that if you have like the degree 10 sum of squares proof, it means that if you have a pseudo-distribution over solutions here, you also have a pseudo-distribution over solutions for the original thing. And if for the original thing there was a small degree sum of squares proof that it has no solution, then you have reached a contradiction, meaning that it cannot be a gap. So basically, the same proof that they used to show that this is an integrality gap for, say, degree 2 plus triangle inequalities, you can use that proof to show that it's actually not an integrality gap for degree degree 10 sum of squares. Because inadvertently, when they proved this soundness thing, they proved something stronger. They didn't just prove that the actual objective is small, they proved also that the sum of squares value is small. So it's kind of interesting, I think, that like inherently their proof, because of the techniques they used, it's not just an accident that it didn't end up with being an integrality gap for the degree 10 sum of squares. It's actually anything that uses similar techniques will not give you an integrality gap like that. So let me tell you like what's the simplest thing that some sense is at the heart of their integrality gap, and it's kind of a useful fact to know. And it's again, once more, something having to do with isoperimetry. So let's talk about what is actually small set expansion, and again at a high level. So generally speaking, if you think of a graph, then you know if you take some large set, if you take some kind of large set in this graph, then by just, even if it was completely random, you'd think that like half of the edges will stay inside this set just because, you know, it's so large, right? But if you take a small set, then maybe, you know, almost all of the edges will go out. And often there are graphs where expansion for small sets is much better than the expansion for large sets. And understanding whether a graph has this property is often very useful. So for example, when sometimes the graphs we are looking at are graphs that describe, say, the evolution of some process, like we're running some kind of probabilistic algorithm, like Monte Carlo map of chain algorithm or something like that. And we want to know at what point we kind of reach the entire graph. So we kind of start with some single point, and we start walking, and you know, this is, in some sense, this is what we can reach after one step, this is what we can reach after two steps, etc. And so it's often the case that if we just look at the expansion of the graph as a way to try to argue that we mix facts fast, it will be very crude and will not get the right result, because we want to take advantage of the fact that this graph expands much more rapidly in the for small sets. So in this beginning of this random walk, you're going to expand much more rapidly. So sometimes we want to ask not the question of what's the what's the set that expands the least in the graph, but say if I give some measure delta, I want to ask what's the set of measure at most delta that expands the least. And basically, the small set expansion hypothesis is that this question is computationally hard, and we don't know the answer to that. But we do have some interesting graphs where a priori it may be not clear how you certify that they have good small set expansion. And here is one example of a graph that's not a great expander, but is a good expander if you think about small sets. And this is, the same.
How small does a set need to be? Is it a constant function?
Yes, so maybe one way to define, for example, you can talk about general parameters, but let's just define that saying that G is a small set expansion if when S is say of little o of the size of the vertices, then the number of edges going from S to its complement becomes like at least 0.99 times the total number of S edges that you can, something like that. So you basically say that if you take in small enough sets, all the edges basically go out, and let's say constant. And let me give you an example of a graph that's not a good expander, but is a good, small set expander in that sense. Or like it becomes a much better expander as you take the sets to be smaller. And this is the following graph. Let's take the vertices to be, again, the Boolean cube. A to be connected to B if their distance, B is at most delta L, or some number delta between 0 and 1. Think of delta as like something, like a very small constant or something like that. So it's not a great expander because you can think of this set S, which is the following. You take basically the first coordinate is 0, and everything is else can be anything. So what's the size of this set? What? Right. The size of the set is half times the number of vertices, or like 2^(n-1). Right. And what's the probability that if you take a guy in the set, what's the probability that you leave the set? So what's the probability that if you take a random A and B, where A is in the set, what's the probability that B is not in the set? Delta, yes. Because in some sense, when you take a random neighbor, it's like flipping every bit with probability delta. So the first bit will be flipping probability delta. So basically, 1 minus delta fraction of the edges stay inside the set. It's not. The graph is not a very good expander. Most of the edges stay inside this set. But it turns out that if you were to look for sets of, say, measure 2 to the minus t, the best thing you could do, so that requires proof, this is basically some kind of an isoperimetric thing, is that the worst sets of measure, so the sets that expand the least, 2 to the minus t, are the form, you know, 0, 0, 0 for the first t coordinates, and the rest is this. And what's the probability here that if you take, say, what's the probability that it's easier, maybe here, let me look at this thing, the probability that you stay inside is 1 minus delta. What's the probability that if A is in S, that B will stay in S? Yes, 1 minus delta to the t, right? You flip it. You flip each bit with probability delta, so the probability that all first t will stay the same, it's 1 minus delta to the t. You can see that once t becomes, say, larger than 1 over delta, then you suddenly start to get very good expansion. Right, so this is an example of a graph that's not a great expander for large sets, but becomes very good expander for small sets. But of course, this requires to prove this isoperimetric inequality. So it requires to prove that for every set of measure 2 to the minus t or something like that, you cannot get something much better than these guys. And basically, this is what this graph was basically what Kotmishnoi had as their initial instance. So that was a small set expander, and there is a sense in which it pretends that you can say that you can print, it pretends to have, you can, I'm not going to show it, but it's not that hard to show that it, you can find pseudo distribution in something that satisfies triangle inequality here and pretends to be of small sets. So, so here is a theorem that I'm not going to prove, but I'm going to kind of sketch why it's true. So here's a theorem. If S is a subset of, you know, 0, 1 to the L, and let's just say S is smaller than 2 to the minus, I don't know, 100 t times 2 to the L, then the probability that if you take A in B, where A in S, that B in S is at most 1 minus delta to the t. Okay, maybe you need to think of it in the range that t and delta are not too crazy, but something like this is true for, say, any constant t or something like that. Okay, so every set, so basically that says that roughly speaking, there are finer theorems that you can prove, like more tighter theorems that you can prove, but basically this says that every set, that the subcubes are the worst case for this Boolean hydrogen. And then you really sketch very roughly how one proves this kind of theorem. And the idea is the following. The idea is you use this fact that we have seen in the lecture notes that, okay, so this Boolean cube, this is a group, right? 0, 1 to the L is a group with the action being the XOR. And we have basically connected every two if so basically we connected A and B if you can get to B from A by XORing with one of the strings with Hamming weight at most delta L. So this means this is a Cayley graph. So this is a Cayley graph. The nice thing about these Cayley graphs, we know, we understand exactly their eigenvector, we can compute their eigenvalues, etc. And the eigenvectors are these functions Right, so first of all, what are eigenvectors? Right, so eigenvectors, an eigenvector of this graph is a vector, so it's a function mapping the vertices to real, say, real numbers, in this case. So an eigenvector is like chi from 0, 1 to the L to R. And it turns out, say, an eigenvector of the Laplacian of the eigenvectors of G and the Laplacian of G are the same. So the eigenvectors of the Laplacian is this chi mapping Z1 to the L to R. And it turns out that we can understand this completely, and basically we have these functions chi S of X, the product of I and S, 1 minus 2 minus 2xi. So these functions are the eigenvectors of this graph, and the corresponding lambda s, these functions really correspond to these subcubes. So the corresponding lambda s will be basically 1 minus delta, I think maybe 1 minus 2 delta or something like that to the size of s or something. Something along those lines. Let's not try to check me. It would be a kind of not supposed, not a spokesman like. it's something along these lines. Like these things always kind of raise. These probabilities are between 0 and 1. The eigenvalues are between -1 and 1. Maybe actually I'm talking about eigenvalues of the Laplacians. Okay, one thing we should say, maybe it's 1 minus, right, if S is 0, this eigenvalue, if S is empty, then this should be 1, this should be 0 for when we're talking about the Laplacian. So I guess it should be, maybe 1 minus this. Yes, I think that's good, because that would be maybe delta is as most like can think of it as most half. So this would be I think it be, this would be okay. Let's say this is the roughly speaking. Let's just say then what we really care about is that lambda s. Lambda s is roughly delta times the size of s in the ranges where we are kind of care about. At some point it becomes something else, but roughly it's like constant times delta times s when you know the size of s is roughly 1 over delta, at most 1 over delta. So that's kind of what we care about. So what we really want to show, in some sense, if you want to show that if you want to show that there is no small set, okay, so now we want to actually prove this thing. So it turns out, what we want to show, we want to show that for every, what we really want to show that for every such set of this measure, what's going on is that if you take 1s, hit it with the Laplacian, I think basically what we want, what comes out at the end is, we want to show that this is roughly this is at least say so let's just say let's just pick something, let's suppose t is like 1 over delta or something like that, then we want to show that say if t is, I don't know, at least 1 over delta or something like that, then we want to show that this thing is at least, I don't know, half or right? We want to show that this thing is at least half. That that will be half times the norm of this guy squared. Right? So the Laplacian, if you remember, it measures the edges. The Laplacian is kind of, Laplacian is like right 1 over d 1 over D sum over I connected to J XI minus XJ squared. So it kind of measures the number of edges that leave the set, and we're going to want to say that that at least half of the edges leave the set. Okay, half of the edges that touch the set leave the set. Right, so this is basically what we need to prove. So another way to say it is that we want to, if we define V to be the span of chi s such that lambda s is at most half, then if we define V to be the span of chi s such that lambda s is at most half, then we want to say that 1s, if s is so small, the 1s is far from the subspace V. Right? It's far from being contained in the set of in the span of eigenvectors that correspond to eigenvalues smaller than half. Most of its mass is the guys that are larger than half, and that's why you'll get at least half, or you know, one third, or whatever. You'll get like at least some constant. Maybe we should say here like I don't know, one third or whatever. So 0.51. This will not maybe enough. So we want to say most of the mass of this guy is not inside this V. So therefore, right, if you hit this guy. If it has at least some amount of mass, let's say 99%, 99.9% of its mass is on the space of eigenvectors that correspond to eigenvalue less larger than say 0.51 or whatever, then you're not going then this thing is going to be large, right? So this is one way to prove what we're trying to prove. We want to say that if you have a large if you have a very small set, its characteristic vector is going to have large quadratic form with the Laplacian. So we want to say that it's very far from the space of vectors that have small eigenvalue for the Laplacian, right? And the point is that this is basically S. Is the this is basically means that s is less than some constant over delta, which by the t we kind of chose it's less than say t or some 10t or whatever. So basically, what is a span? Right. So what is the span of all chi s's that have at most say size where s is at most t? What does it mean if f is of the form sum over alpha s chi s where s is of size at most t? You know, remember f is some function from 0, 1 to the L to R, and the chi s's are these. So what does it mean? What does it say about
this? Is this microeconomic?
As far from that as possible. Maybe she might be talking about expansion of the economy. I think hyperconductivity is like the Greek term, you know, it's right, so what is a function f that is of the form sum alpha s chi s, where chi s are these functions and s has size at most t? You have a name for functions like that, right? Not the polynomials, polynomials of degree at most t, right? So we want to show, basically what we want to show is that for every s like that, you cannot find a polynomial. You cannot find a polynomial that is close to it. So that polynomials are not close. Polynomials of degree t are not close to sets that have measure 2 to the minus 100 t. And if you think about it, it kind of makes sense. how would you get, you know, if you wanted a polynomial to be kind of as sparse as possible, it kind of seems like you would basically look at, you know, 1 minus, say, you look just basically at x1 times xt, right? Like the greedy polynomial, that kind of would be, you know, it will only be non-zero when one of those xi's is non-zero. And it seems like that's kind of the best you could do, but this is basically what you want to prove. But so let's just try to prove that one s that you cannot get. Okay, this is where actually now I see it's really bad. I'm using this s as both here and here. Okay, let's call this set. Okay, let's call these guys, I don't know, T. Capital T. Okay, so what you want to show is that, let's just at least try to show that 1s is not a polynomial like that. And I guess we don't have a lot of time, but one thing we can say about the set 1s, and this is the following thing, that expectation of 1s when x is 0, 1 to the L, what is this expectation? It's just the size of S, so let's write it to the 4. It doesn't matter if it's to the 4, right? It's the size of L divided by 2 to the L. In our case, it's like 2 to the minus 100 T, right? And this is the same if I wrote in 4 or 2, it didn't matter. So in particular, what I can say is that the expectation of 1S to the 4 is larger than 2 to the 100 T times the expectation of 1s squared squared. Right, so this is, so I'll just finish by saying one thing and then we'll end because we're out of time, but so, right, so if a space set is sparse, in particular, it means that the expectation of 1s to the 4 is much larger than the expectation of 1s squared squared. In some sense, one way to measure sparsity is that somehow the 4 norm is much larger than the 2 norm. And then it turns out that this is a theorem. It's called, I think, Vector, Bonomi, I don't know, Gross, hyperconductivity theorem, that if P, if say F is a degree, at most T polynomial, then the expectation over the Boolean cube of F to the 4 is at most 9 to the D expectation over f squared squared. And this is, so this is a theorem. And this theorem implies, it turns out that this theorem implies that f cannot be actually a sparse set, but it also can be shown to imply that it cannot even be close to a sparse set, and show it implies the hyperconductivity of the Boolean cube. But the nice thing about this theorem is that it's an inequality. It's an inequality if you think about it in the coefficients of f, and it's like a degree, like a degree 4 inequality, and it turns out that you can prove it by showing that this minus this is a sum of squares. And because of that, sum of squares algorithm knows that the Boolean cube, noisy Boolean cube is an expander, and because of that, and some a lot of other work, it can break the proportional integrality gap. So let's stop here.